Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'll now request Mr. Naveen Chandra B. Vasoya, President, Institution of Engineers India, to kindly welcome the guest this morning.
Distinguished delegates, guests, ladies and gentlemen, today we have with us Dr. Sarath Kumar Acharya, Chairman cum Managing Director, Neyveli Lignite Corporation Limited, a distinguished speaker who has occupied a place of high eminence amongst the engineering fraternity. We feel honored as we get this privilege of sharing the valuable thoughts of this stalwart of engineering profession. I now request Major General S. Bhattacharya, Secretary and Director General of the institution, to formally present the brief of this eminent personality in this grand occasion. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Acharya studied and graduated from the Ravenshaw College in the year 1977 and obtained his master's in personal management and labor welfare from Utkal University in the year 1979. Dr. Acharya is engaged in spreading the wings of NLC India Limited, the Navratna company of the Government of India that he leads, to various parts of the country with diverse business portfolios, transiting from a lignite mining and lignite-based power company to an energy major with big forays into coal mining, coal-based power generation, and generation of power from renewable energy sources like solar and wind. Dr. Acharya also holds the position of chairman in NLC Tamil Nadu Power Limited and Neyveli Uttar Pradesh Power Limited, engaged in coal-based thermal power generation and project construction. He carries with him a very rich and varied experience of over 37 years working in BHEL, NTPC, NTPC Sail Power Company, and NLCIL. In April 2016, he received the Scope Excellence Award from the Honorable President of India. He is a fellow of NIPM and a Lifetime Achievement Awardee by Green Tech Foundation for promoting sustainable HR and CSR. He has been conferred fellowship by the World Academy of Productivity Sciences and has also been confirmed with a doctorate degree by the Satyabhama University, Tamil Nadu, and D.Lit by Utkal University, Odisha, and also the highest NIPM Ratna Award by National Institute of Personal Management of India. Dr. Acharya, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Bhattacharya. Good morning, the President, Mr. Bhattacharya, and all my friends over here. My greetings to entire engineering fraternity from NLC India Limited, the Navratna Mining and Power Company of Government of India, where I happen to be the first worker along with 30,000 people working directly and indirectly for the company. It is my privilege to be here with you today to talk to you, the eminent engineers, as a common man. I will view the engineering, the entire community of engineers, those who are engaged in creating all good things for the benefit of mankind. From a common man's point of view, the way we all thought about the engineering as an education, we all are experiencing about engineering as a profession. And the engineering that is emerging now in rapidly changing world scenario, where the engineering is no more limited to the traditional civil, electrical, or mechanical engineering that we knew of. I go back to my early days when engineering used to be the first choice for career, and most of the parents were preparing, rather dreaming, to send the children to study engineering. Next perhaps was the medical, and rest very few could be aiming for normal thing, maybe civil services and others. And today also, the trend continues to be mostly so. Many parents feel that yes, my son or daughter becomes an engineer, contributes to the society, and of course, getting admission into engineering used to be very tough those days. I will not say that now, with lot many engineering institutes mushrooming around, and the craze while continues, but not many are making it to the top. Yes, India is proud of Mr. Visvesvaraya, Satish Dhawan, Rajeshwari Chatterjee, Sridharan, to name a few. But among the total engineering graduates now turning out, how many of them are making it to the top through the technology and engineering innovations? And that is what perhaps the country needs now. Coming out of a mediocre engineering college, getting into jobs with 30,000, 40,000 rupees a month, doing the mundane things over there, that is what most of our engineering activities are getting limited there. But doing something beyond the basics, and from the basics, going and embracing the concept of technology and technological innovation, these are the things where individually not many are making it. India, for giving the institutional support through the academic institutes, maybe the IITs, maybe the NITs, maybe specifically tailor-made research organizations, we don't have much to our credit. Not even many of the IITs make it to the top 100 so far as world standards are concerned. And once we talk of the digital movement, the technology, and the global innovation standards, while Singapore ranks better than us, while many small countries, they are much ahead of us, we rank 41 over there. Coming to the GDP, we aim to go for the double digit, but always we compare with the developing country that we refer always, China, having a similar population or maybe slightly, but the population growth is one thing that we grapple with, they also grapple with. But the growth in terms of GDP, in terms of technology, and in terms of innovation, where are we? That is what perhaps this engineering congress should think and debate upon. Can there be rapid industrial innovation on engineering side for developing new technologies, imbibing new technologies? And the traditional curriculum that we have in engineering so far, perhaps if we take into account the new things that are happening around, we find still that we are limited to basics. doing the normal things, perhaps handling a machine or doing the routine things. I'm not talking of engineering marvels or engineering wonders, where if I tell that, yes, we used to be proud of the Howrah Bridge, any support from one end to the other, extending the cantilever concept to the greater heights, perhaps after so many years, we added that kind of a parallel Howrah Bridge. It is not, it is there in Calcutta on the other side after so many years. The bridges and the railway bridges that were made mostly during the British time are getting replaced. And also we come across the cases where the bridges or the things that are getting built somehow not seeing the quality that we require. So all these things should also ask us that churning out the engineers with engineering degrees and not giving them adequate input in tandem with the present day world scenario. What is the role of the academic institutions? What is the role of the government? What is the role of the organizations that we lead? We have to foster the innovation, the technology, the R&D, and our R&D spend somehow is almost negligible. Yes, we have organizations like ISRO to be proud of, but can be one ISRO or DRDO lead the innovation or put the innovation foundation for the country to propel? The present government is absolutely strongly they're putting forward this propelling machine as the growth machine to be driven from Niti Aayog side, creating innovative platforms for replicating technology, those which have been developed and adopted in the world for creating engineering marvels. And then replicating in Indian context, giving the benefit out of that, be it in terms of construction, be it in terms of automation, be it in terms of the harnessing the energy and the power all over. So all those things are going to take time, but nevertheless, with the zeal and enthusiasm that our engineers are showing, not only on the war front, but also on the front of doing excellent things in research and seminars, that shows us that we don't lack in terms of capabilities. But to harness those capabilities and potential, the supporting and the institutional foundation is to be strengthened, and that is what we should be aiming at. And here, we are still not out of that Jugaad concept. Most of the cases, in fact, many of the times, we tell proudly that if there is a problem, we'll come up with a solution, and that could be a knee-jerk solution, where it is not a permanent one. It is to just overcome that difficulty, that problem, we come out with a temporary solution, what we call Jugaad. And India is rich in Jugaads, but very frugal in developing the new and innovative technology permanently. Dear friends, as I told, I'm not a pessimist. I'm not telling that we cannot do. Perhaps the thrust towards that, to harness the I can do spirit, and also to get the institutional mindset to promote the research orientation. That is what something I should be emphasizing. And these days, the world is converging. Converging in terms of technology, in terms of communication, in terms of visual and interactive methods. Whatever happens at one place is not limited to that place only. It becomes viral, and it catches everybody. But it catches everybody. We are perhaps second. We are happy to allow the Google to operate here. And we have many companies working for us, the giants, like in my company, the mining and the power company that we have. We have Mitsubishi, Mitsui, Caterpillar, Tyson Group, they all are working with us. But L&D and our Indian companies, Indian multinationals, are second fiddle to them. They are just learning from them. And here the technology, Adam Sarwar is developing the technology. Then we should be the pilot to do it. For that, of course, as I told, the research.